So, let's talk about the Mayfly Hatch. The Mayfly Hatch is one of my favorite things that happens during the summer because it is such an awesome opportunity to catch a lot of really, really big bass doing all the things that I like to do. And the shallow water power fishing side of me gets to come out and it gets to shine because those mayflies attract a lot of bluegill that attract a lot of really big bass that are really hungry because they just got done spawning. And it all just kind of comes together in this awesome opportunity to put big bass into the boat, the bank, the kayak, or wherever you guys happen to be fishing. And this year's Mayfly Hatch is even cooler because it coincided with a shad spawn that was followed closely by a cicada hatch, which was followed closely by a mayfly hatch, which all kind of worked together with a bluegill and brim spawn, which all got kind of concocted together in this big amalgamation of just shallow water fishing goodness that has given everybody in the country some really, really cool opportunities to catch bass shallow, to catch bass on power fishing techniques, and just to have a freaking blast. But all that being said, today we're focusing on the Mayfly Hatch and the baits and some tips and tricks that I think you guys need to have to make sure that you're optimizing your time on the water and you're putting as many big fish into the boat as you possibly can. So, without further ado, let's get into this thing. We're going to start with the baits and then we'll move into some tips and tricks and things that I've kind of picked up over the years of fishing different Mayfly Hatches to put big bass in the boat. Three baits. I've always got three baits rigged up and ready to go for the Mayfly Hatch, and it doesn't matter if I'm in my boat or if I'm in my kayak or where I'm at. If I know that there's a mayfly hatch happening or if there's a potential for a mayfly hatch to happen, I have these three baits rigged up and ready to go. Now, the first one is not going to be a surprise to anyone that's been around the channel for any amount of time, and that is going to be the hollow body frog. I love a hollow body frog. Spring, summer, fall, it is one of the best tools that I've got in the boat to put big fish into the boat. But during the mayfly hatch, it's awesome because not only does it do a really good job of mimicking mayflies, right? You can play with the colors, you can play with the size, make that thing look like a little mayfly up there on the top, but it does a really good job of mimicking the bluegill and the brim and the other bait fish that are actually up there eating on those mayflies. And oftentimes, and more often than not, that's what the bass want to be keyed in on. A bluegill or a brim or a bait fish is a much bigger, more nutrient-rich, fat and protein-rich meal that is a lot more worth an expenditure of energy for the bass than that little bitty mayfly floating on top. Now, that being said, I've seen 6 and 7 pounders that key in on one little mayfly and they eat it. They take whatever opportunity they can get. But more oftentimes than not, if you want to key on the bigger bass, if you want to key in on the bass that are more actively feeding and looking for that bigger meal, mimicking the bluegill and the brim and all the other little bait fish up there eating those mayflies is going to be what you're going to want to do. And this frog is going to do an awesome job of that. Now, I like a frog versus, say, something like a popper or a walking style bait more because I can put this frog into places I can't put those baits. Any treble hook topwater style bait, popper, a walking style bait, any of that that you try to skip under a boat dock or skip under overhanging limbs is just going to get fouled up, it's just going to get hung up, and it's just going to be a waste of an opportunity. Whereas this little frog, you can put it in all of those places. It doesn't matter if you're throwing it into root bases, throwing it into limbs, throwing it into overhangs, throwing it under docks, brush piles, whatever it is, the frog is able to get in and get out of those places a lot better. And a lot of the times when you're looking for those mayflies, especially those big concentration of mayflies, you're looking for those overhanging limbs. I mean, I've seen times when the mayflies are so thick that limbs literally droop down and they touch the water, and there will be bluegill circling all around those limbs, and under those bluegill are those bass. And when you present those bass with the opportunity of what looks like a dying bluegill on top, they will absolutely take it and they will crush the frog. And so I like this over, say, the walking, the popping style bait, just because of the opportunity for me to be able to put it in places you can't put those baits and being able to get it out of those places as well. I also love the frog because it's what I like to call finesse topwater. Now, I know what you're saying, 7'3" heavy rod, 40-pound braid, there's nothing finesse about it. But if you really think about it, there's no treble hooks hanging off the bottom of this thing. There's no rattles. It's smaller than most topwaters. It's very subtle, doesn't disturb a lot of water. So even if you're fishing around a lot of pressured fish that either have fed all night on mayflies and bluegills and things like that, or you're fishing around fish that 1,000 other people fish for, if they're throwing the popper, if they're throwing the walking bait, not only can you get this bait where they can not get their bait, but you can also give them a very subtle passive presentation that oftentimes will get a really, really big bite. Now, as far as colors and things, like I said, you can either do a really good job of mimicking the mayflies, which oftentimes will do a really good job of mimicking the bluegills as well, or you can try to mimic the bluegill. Your choice is yours. I mean, I do a little bit of both. Sometimes I'll try to mimic mayflies. Sometimes I'll try to mimic bluegill. Oftentimes I try to mimic both. Or you do things like I do and throw the freak color here, which mimics absolutely nothing. But this freak color, I don't know what it is about it, guys, but it works. I love this color. I have 6 of these in the boat at any one time. And literally all I do is I wear one completely out until the hooks are all bent and the barbs are pressed down. The color's completely off of it. And then I pick up the next one and I do the same thing to it. But this freak color, not really sure what it is. Clear water, up north, down south, dirty water. This thing gets work done. That broken up pattern on the belly, really what that broken up pattern looks like is a bullfrog. If you ever seen a bullfrog, flip a bullfrog over, it has that pattern on its belly. And so I just think that broken up look does a good job of mimicking a little bit of everything. You know, a good dark base, got a little bit of yellow in there, got some green and yellow and black in the tails. It's not any one particular thing, but it's a lot of different things that bass like to eat. And so I think bass eat it because it does look like a bunch of different stuff. But freak is one of my absolute favorite colors across the board for frog fishing, but definitely during the mayfly hatch because there's something about it that those bass key in on. And I'm throwing that on a 7.3 Abu Garcia Veritas PLX. This is the heavy, fast action. I got that paired up with a Revo STX and some 40-pound braid. I like the 40-pound braid. I've been experimenting with it. And what I've found is, obviously, you get to cast a little bit further. It doesn't want to bind into itself as bad as like the 50 and the 60-pound braid. I found that, especially when I'm skipping this bait, that a lot of times it'll skip, and with braid, there's, I mean, it's an inevitable thing that's going to happen. It doesn't really backlash. It just kind of digs. And with the 50 and the 60, it would dig a lot more than this 40 does. And so just for efficiency, I like the 40. Now, when it comes to mat fishing, obviously, I'm going to bump back up. But right now, open water frog fishing, walking the frog, it seems to be a key. And it also does a really good job of helping me to walk the frog. And that's a huge key. That's going to be a kind of tip that I drop on you guys right now, is learn to walk the frog. And the only tips I can really give you to learning to walk the frog is hit the slack just like any other topwater, but just get the bait in your hand and go play with it, because every frog walks a little bit different. This is a Spro Bronze Eye 65, and so I know how this thing walks, but I've got the Trash Panda that walks a little bit different. I've got the Spro Spittin' Shad that walks a little bit different. I got the Norries that walks a little bit different. Each frog walks a little bit different. And so I've kind of committed myself to learning how to walk this particular frog just for efficiency's sake. And now that I've kind of got it figured out, I can walk it really, really easy. But just getting it in your hand, keeping it in your hand is the biggest thing, because during the mayfly hatch, during really any time of the year when I'm throwing the frog, when you skip it up under that boat dock, you know, you don't want to just pop it straight out. You want to let that thing hang, really give those fish an opportunity to get agitated by it, to key in on it, to want to eat it. And oftentimes, like I said, whether you're fishing around fish that have been eating mayflies all night or fishing around a ton of other fishermen, having that bait just kind of sitting there 180ing back and forth, really hanging in those fish's face, oftentimes can get them to commit to it even when they're not really apt to commit to it. You just get them to react. Something finally moves on that bait the right way, or you pop it just violently enough that they just come unloaded on it. So walking the frog can be a game changer, an absolute game changer when it comes to mayfly hatch fishing, but really frog fishing in general. So learn to walk your frog. Now the next bait, again, probably not going to be a surprise to many of you guys, such a killer bait, especially during the mayfly hatch. And this is for kind of a different reason. This is going to be a kind of different thing that I've noticed. But the second one's going to be a wacky rig. And a wacky rig, again, looks like dying mayflies, looks like dying bluegill, looks like dying shad. You know, that good dark base mimics a little bit of everything. It's not one particular thing, but it's a lot of different things. But there's two really key details about the wacky rig that I think make it such a good tool for the mayfly hatch. The first one being the fact that it kind of just hangs in those fish's face. Obviously, it sinks, but it sinks very, very slowly. And that's kind of the key to the wacky rig. You just have this kind of shimmying bait coming through the water column. And I've seen a lot of times when they'll roll on the frog and not really commit to it, that you can pick up the wacky rig and absolutely smash those fish, because they're not really wanting to come completely on top and to eat the frog. They kind of want something down in the column with them, and that's where the wacky rig can chime. But another thing that I think it does is when you see emerging mayflies, so mayflies that are actively hatching, a mayfly is actually born in the water, and they come from the bottom, they float up to the top, they crack out their little exoskeletons, and away they fly. And really, what's crazy about that is if you've ever seen those little mayfly larvae coming to the top, they kind of do this weird, like, kicking thing like this. Literally looks just like this. I mean, you guys can see, you start that shaking. You ever seen a wacky rig fall through the water? Or if you pulse it, it's kind of got this weird pulsy thing going. That does an excellent job of looking just like that. And so you're gonna get a lot of bites from bluegills and things like that. A lot of times you're gonna miss a lot of those fish. But if you can find those bass that are keyed in on that very specific type of deal where those mayflies are actually coming up through the water column that haven't hatched out into the like flying form yet, you can get some work done. And I think many, many times that I've not realized that the mayfly hatch is coming, that I've picked up the wacky rig trying to mimic bluegill and brim, and realize later on in the evening when the mayflies actually hatched that that wacky rig was doing a really good job of mimicking those mayflies. I got the opportunity to see that several years ago, just fishing right before dark, and you see these little things just pulsing their way up through the top of the water, and they'd hit the top of the water, crack open, and there the mayfly would go. And it was just, it was a wild deal. It was one of those deals that it kind of dawned on me. I was like, my God, a wacky rig looks just like that. And so ever since then, you know, I think that that wacky rig, again, does a good job of looking like a little bit of everything, but that kind of one specific thing it does a really good job of as well. But I'm fishing that 7-foot Veritas PLX, a 7-foot medium fast action, Abu Garcia Zeta, 300 size reel, some 20-pound braid to a 10-pound fluorocarbon leader, and that's kind of my go-to setup there. A lot of people ask about the braid and the fluorocarbon. This is Power Pro Vermilion Red. I like the Vermilion Red. I got turned on to it by Mr. Benjamin Nowak. It stands out against green and blue water really, really well, so you can see it really, really well when you're fishing it. And then some 10-pound FC Sniper, Sunline FC Sniper. The best leader material that I've found. It's really expensive, but one 200 yard spool last year for, I mean, a year and a half if you let it, because I usually only do a rod length, a rod and a half length of leader material when I actually do tie one. But killer opportunity there with that, because it does look like specific things, does look like a lot of things, and it also is just a bait that will hang in those fish's face that when they're not really wanting to commit to the frog, they're not really blowing up on it, if the wacky rig is a tool that you can pick up and you can put fish on the boat. Now this last one is going to be one that, again, this is the big fish bait. This is the one that I feel like when you're looking for that bigger than average fish, when you're wanting to do a really good job of mimicking bluegills and mimicking brim, that you pick this one up, and it's going to be an opportunity that oftentimes when you swing, every swing is going to be a big one, and that is going to be a flipping jig. And I love a flipping jig during the mayfly hatch, because again, like I said, I want to mimic a bluegill. Not only do I want to mimic a bluegill, but I want to mimic that bluegill that's that big bluegill, that bluegill that is like that double quarter pounder with cheese, large fries, and a Diet Coke. That thing that's really worth that bass's time. Now, flipping bait, I love a flipping bait. You guys know that I flip all the time. But when I'm looking for that big, big bite, the flipping jig is going to be what I go to. Now, this is the brand new Beast Coast Little Magnum. This is our brand new grass hybrid flipping jig. This thing is really cool because it is a weight forward tungsten headed jig. So that tungsten head is going to give it a smaller, more compact kind of presentation. And what that does is it helps that jig to fall a lot faster and always have the tails of your trailer activated. And so it's going to look like a dying bluegill, a dying brim. It's going to do a really good job of mimicking that big meal, that big opportunity that those fish want. And also, by falling a little bit quicker, you're going to get those fish to react. I think many times, more often than not, when you're flipping, it's the bait falling fast and getting the bass to react, rather than getting them to eat, that actually puts fish into the boat. I think too many people, when they flip, they think, oh, this is a slow presentation, when really they need to be flipping in, pumping it a couple times and moving on to the next target, and you're getting those fish to react to that. And so I get them to react by fishing that tungsten headed jig. It's going to fall a lot faster. It's going to get to the bottom a lot faster. I'm fishing a half ounce size. Right now I got green pumpkin on. Green pumpkin, again, going to do a good job of looking like a little bit of everything, looking like those bluegill, looking like those brim, and even sometimes, if you're real, real lucky, looking like a mayfly. I mean, that's obviously a lot bigger than a mayfly, but if those bass are keen in on those mayfly, oftentimes, if it looks like it and the profile is similar enough, the bass are gonna eat it. But just fishing that little bit faster falling jig in those green pumpkins, in those bluegill imitators, is gonna be what gets work done. But like I said, Beast Coast Little Magnum, half ounce, dropping fast, green pumpkin, got that paired up with a Berkeley Chigger Craw on the pack. In green pumpkin again. What's really cool about the skirt on this jig is even though it is a green pumpkin, it contrasts really well to like a plastic green pumpkin. And what I mean by that is like a poured plastic, like your actual trailer, oftentimes will be a little bit darker than this skirt. And so you get this really good kind of contrast and depth to the bait that makes it look like a bluegill even more than it actually is. But the jig, man, so big. Fishing in all the same places you fish your frog or your wacky rig, flipping it and skipping it, putting it in those places where those bass are going to be, around those mayflies, around those overhanging limbs, where those mayflies want to be. But this is just going to be that bigger piece of meat, that big, loud presentation, dropping fast, getting those bass to react to try to put those bigger than average fish into the boat. Now I'm fishing this 20-pound fluorocarbon, straight fluorocarbon on here. 7.3 Veritas PLX, a 7.3 heavy fast action with a Revo X on there, 7.3 gear ratio, and this is just my standard flipping set. It's what I flip like creature baits and those kinds of things on. It's also what I flip my flipping jigs on as well. But just getting in there, getting out, having that big heavy rod, that big heavy line, be able to smack them in the face and get them out of whatever they're in and put them into the boat. But really, those three, those are the key for me. Those are the three key baits that I'm always going to have with me, always going to have ready for the mayfly hatch to try to put a lot of bass in the boat. And there's a lot of other great baits out there, especially up north. You know, the jerk bait can be a killer deal. The hair jig can be a killer deal, as they can down here. But I think as far as like optimizing your time on the water and getting the most bites that you possibly can, those three right there, if one of those three don't work, you just need to load it up and go to the house. But yeah, guys. Thank you for watching. Questions or comments, you know where to go leave them. Go down in the description. I have all the gear that I used linked down below. You guys can go check it out. And as always, you guys are sweet. Thank you for watching.